Lord, I ask you to move tonight in the name of Jesus. I ask you, God, to pour your spirit out tonight in a powerful way. And like David said in the Psalms, he needed the Holy Spirit, even in the Old Testament. And how much more can we have what David even had in the New Covenant? Lord, I ask you to just pour your spirit out. Glory, hallelujah. Woo! Glory, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Phew. I ask you to pour your spirit out tonight, Lord, in the name of Jesus, and just move in a powerful way and just touch everyone here and everyone that might be watching around the world. Just bless us, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Just move in a powerful way, Lord, in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. And we call in a harvest, Lord, in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Glory, hallelujah. Glory, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. In the name of Jesus. We call in a financial harvest too, Lord, so we can get a building. We call in the souls to come in too, Lord, and we just bless Lord, what you're doing here, and we ask you just to come down, Lord, and bless us, Lord, and when we add on the Sunday morning service and the classes and children's church and all, bless it, Lord, and bless the children's church, Lord, and let them grow and even pass us spiritually, Lord, in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Amen. I guess I could do a little announcements first. I guess we can do that, can't we? And I get into it later. And we're starting, everybody here knows, starting next Sunday, we're going to add on a Sunday morning service too. So praise the Lord. It'll probably be packed Sunday mornings. And eventually then it will get packed on Sunday nights too. Yeah. I like Sunday nights. That's when I feel the Lord moves in the night services more. And, later on in the day. And so that's exciting. I'm not a very good morning person, so just bear with me on that. And I asked Charlotte, she'll have to help me preach a lot because preaching two services can get you. And I'm not going to be the type of person that thinks that I have to control everything and be the person that's preaching all the time and stuff like that, because you'll find out real quickly that won't last. I've seen a lot of them, it won't last. It won't. That's why Bethel and Toronto and some of them last so long, because they have different speakers that come in. And that's the plan. We added an event calendar on the website. You can go to revivalthisyear.org. /events. It's a nice little calendar. You can click on classes, and everybody, you get with me how you want to do yours, and I can add it on there. And it's really nice, and you can share it to people and stuff. We bought the plug-in, and it's really nice. It took me a whole week to get it, literally the whole week last week, getting that taken care of, but it's working good now. And updated the network site and did some work on that, and I hope that grows. It's a social network. We could really use that for the children and youth a lot, and it's the top of the line. It's really nice, and I just wanted to mention that and just get that out of the way, take it, during announcements. And so we'll still have Sunday nights too, and so I'm really excited about that. Neil is gone. He will be gone, I think, tomorrow and not come back to the following Monday, I think. He will be at Bethel Church. So I guess they're having this conference about the supernatural school, how churches can get that started. And he, God told him to go to that, and he wants to see about how it's run, how they do stuff there at the church and stuff. And I said, you can start it out here as part of Revival Is Here. And he didn't say no to that. So he said he wasn't in competition. And I've been on him about being an associate for a while. And we can have more than one associate anyway. And we'll see how that goes. But I just wanted to mention that and get that taken care of. And Lord, just come down tonight in the name of Jesus. Ask you, God, just to pour your spirit out in a powerful way tonight, Lord. Just let your glory roll up in this place, Lord. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Next week, I might hopefully have that lapel mic in.
Oh, it's good. It's good. It's good to be in the house of the Lord. It is. Whenever you're ready, we're gonna kick off kind of loud and proud. We want other people to know that we're in here, right? You know, we don't always feel like worshiping, and we don't always feel like dancing, and we don't always feel like clapping, and we don't always feel like giving God glory. But I'm telling you, the fact that I got up this morning, the fact that I traveled over 2,500 miles this week and still got up this morning and feel like being here is just amazing to me. And it's just a hunger. It's a hunger to be in the presence of God. I'm a little bit hot on this mic because I keep being more quiet and it just keeps getting louder. And I know that when I really get excited, it's going to be way too loud. So, but anyways, praise how you want to, worship how you want to, as long as when you worship, you're worshiping from the bottom of your toes to the top of your lungs. Before we start, I want to share something real quick. And you're going to be amazed by this because it has to do with worship. One of the ladies that I was working with last week had the opportunity a few years back to go up in a hot air balloon on a Sunday morning. And she said that they were up and, you know, you get up so high and you think that it's peaceful and quiet. She said, you can hear people on the ground talking. She said, you can hear everything they're saying. And it's just a hum. And she said that on this Sunday morning, they happened to go over top of a church. And she said it had to have been a black gospel church. But she went over this, they flew over this church. And in between them putting the gas to the balloon in that quiet time, they could hear the people in that church shouting definite hallelujahs and definite praises. And I thought, man, could you imagine what our Lord hears in the heavens on Sundays? I mean, could you imagine what he hears on Monday? I mean, come on now. I know people that don't like Mondays, but I'm thinking, golly, how awesome to be in the heavens and hear the praises of the people coming up. And coming up, and she only confirmed to me, you know, he says, I hear everything. I see everything. And could you imagine the perspective that he has from here, looking down and listening to every single person and what they say? Oh, come on. That gets me excited because, you know, she's of a different denomination, of a different belief, but the fact that she recognized the praises and the shouts. Oh, man. Oh, man. Go ahead, Anthony. Let's Lord in this place. Oh, holy God. Oh, holy God. And he says, I am here to dwell among my people. To dwell among my people. Yet my people don't even know what that means. In my presence is fullness. Everything you need, I have. I don't care what people say to you. They don't know who you are. And they don't know who I am. And I will dwell among my people. I am your God. I am with you now. I am with you always. when you come and when you go, and when you rise and when you rest. You are the very essence of my glory, my creation. I rest upon you. I dwell within you. I encompass everything around you. I see all. I hear all. I know all. I'm everywhere, all the time. I never rest. I'm never absent. I'm never too busy. I am always here. I am always here. The hardest times of your life, the saddest times of your life, the joyous times of your life, the times you were most fearful, the times you were the strongest. It was because I was there. I was with you. I dwelt with you. You sought me and I answered. I came, but you didn't recognize me. But I am with you. I am with you now, and I am with you always. You are my people, and I am your God. I am. Whew. Thank you, Lord. We thank you, Lord. Oh, we thank you, Lord. Our hearts cry, thank you. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Open your mouth and tell him thank you. He's never left you. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. If I can never say anything else, Lord, I thank you. 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 Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. There's such a sweet presence right now. Just a holy, holy presence in this place. And, wow. Pastor Chan, I'm going to turn this over to you. I just want to stay right here for a minute, though, and thank the Lord that this thing is strong. And that this is good wood. Amen. It's good wood. Ooh, Jesus.
Glory. Stay in the spirit. And real quick, God has wanted me to say something, and he kind of put it on my heart a while back, and something happened to confirm it. But here in May, I don't know when, a few Sundays, take up a special offering for Global Awakening to send up there as a donation, for because they send and they do missionary work around the world. I just wanted to mention that. So just kind of put something to the side, and we try to help and give, and we've always have. I know we've been small, but God has been, that's the way He's worked with us, to give to other ministries and stuff. And I believe that's why we're still here. And I just wanted to mention that real quick. And if you want, I think everybody's got their offerings, but it's up front here. God told me not to be focused on money here at this church, that He'll take care of it. So that's what He's always been. I don't worry about it, you know. And if God wants it done, He'll provide the money to do it. That's the way I see it. And you can turn that other light on, Charles Wayne. You can start the recording, the audio. And God gave me a several words. I'm trying to remember all of them. He's gave me several words to give out here. Stay in the spirit here. And one thing I see with Algeria, God is going to do a work. He's told me that I feel really in my spirit about Algeria. I feel that God said that He's going to raise up some intercessors to intercede for Algeria. And God said He's going to pour out an intercession session anointing tonight on some people for really get into deep intercession. And I feel an intercession for Algeria too. God said He's going to do a work in Algeria. I see some hungry souls, and I see a move of God in Algeria. I see that. And several weeks ago, God showed me a vision. And when God showed me this, I felt that, well, you know, at the time, the church wasn't going to last another couple Sundays, so I knew this was from God. It wasn't from me, and we were set up the other way at the time, and I was looking over towards Charles Wayne, but it didn't have anything to do with him, but I was looking towards, like, this way when I saw it, and I saw a vision of a lot of young people bunched together, and it was packed. Bunched together, a part of revival is here, and I see them. What was highlighted that was praise and worship. They was praising worship in the Lord, and I feel the highlight. I think of the youth group, and I'm not setting telling anybody what to do here, but I see one of the highlights of the youth group here is a praise and worship, and there's going to be a dynamic of praise and worship and hungry for the Lord and really praising the Lord, and I feel. Some people will almost rather be in, and I'm not running down me and the other services, but I feel that some people would almost rather be in the young people's service. It's going to be so good instead of if they had a choice. I know when I went to a church that was in, well, it was Brownsville Revival when I went down there in 95, they had a room, several different buildings for overflow, and one of the buildings for overflow was the younger people went to that building. That's where they went instead of in. And they had the same service. It was just overflow. And people would rather go in that building with the young people because of the Spirit of the Lord. And I thought that was something. And glory, hallelujah. Glory, hallelujah. I think the Lord's going to anoint your worship. And I think you'll be able to... I'm just going to say this. For a while, I got out of prophetic because the things I said, God showed me about revival is here, and the things I prophesied to the people, I just kind of got out of it. You know, I kind of, and it does seem to where some of the people that really flow strongly in the prophetic, they had a time where they got out of it and didn't want anything to do with it. Look at Elijah, you know, and there's most of the people that they're like that. It happened. Not always, but it has happened. Most of the time. But I see a highlight with you is teaching children with praise and worship and youth. I don't just, you know, younger people about praise and worship. And I think that's a highlight of what's in your heart, I feel. And God's going to give you that gift. He's gave you that gift, but I think He's going to put a stronger anointing on you even now. I see a stronger anointing on you that's falling on you in the name of Jesus. Glory. Hallelujah. Glory, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. More, Lord. Glory, hallelujah. There has been words given over revival is here, and God has shown me a lot since I was, pretty much since I got born again when I was young. I don't know what my, don't know if I was 10 or old, younger than that. To be honest with you, I don't know. I know I was young. And God showed me, he showed me a lot of visions. And I seen a vision with a lot of stadium stuff, me preaching at stadium type of things. And I think the revival is here. I think it's going to be a part of it, too, is going out to stadiums, and we're going to see stadiums filled. I just see that, and this has been given words over us about that, and that's what I see. And I'm just going to step out in faith to say that. And I really feel strong about God's going to do something in Algeria. I don't know if it's to do with revival is here or global awakening to go there or what, but I feel that. And there's another thing I felt led to say was I was reading I got a new book. Chris Vallotton and Bill Johnson wrote together, and about supernatural ways of royalty. And he said, I believe it was Chris was writing this part. He said in one of the services at Bethel, Randy was doing it, and he rebuked the devil out of people, and people started manifesting. And one lady, they had to drag her out. They was going to try to drag her to a room. She got so mad, got so bad, they could only get her to the hallway. And a team was praying for her. Then he come out to help out, and they was really wasn't doing a good job. They felt like you had to fight them and fight the devil and scream and holler. And I think they was making as much noise as the person, a lady that was manifesting. And they smarted off to him and said, well, you do it if you think he can do any better, basically is what they said. But anyway, what I wanted to highlight is God showed him that she had some unforgiveness towards her father that she had to give. And she said, first she said she didn't have anybody to forgive. Then she said, God showed him about her father, and she said she hated her father. And that opened the door to her possession or, the devil in her life. And when she let that go, she become free instantly. And maybe somebody watching, but I just felt led to say that, talk about, just forgive people, and it's good to forgive people and just let it go. That's not saying that you can't learn from it, and that doesn't mean that you have to just go hang out with them every day and all that. That's not what it means, but kind of let it go. I know it's hard, trust me. You have to just get to the point, you just give it to God, help. That one guy said, Lord, help my unbelief. I believe, help my unbelief. Say, Lord, I forgive, but help me to forgive more. He'll help you. Sometimes God, as a grace that God can give you to forgive people. And it's only has to be a lot of times from the Lord. And I felt led to say that. Just kind of let it go. In this area, there does seem to be an unforgiveness spirit in this area. And somebody might say, oh, you don't know what they used to do. They can't be a minister now. You don't know what they used to do. What did you used to do? I want to know. We all got a past. We've all done something. We've all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. But here, the thing is, where are you now? Do you genuinely want to see God move? Or is there pride, or do you just want to see God move and you want to do God's work? There's a difference. I could look at someone now and tell. I can tell with Charlotte, she genuinely wants to do God's work. And everybody here, y'all genuinely want to do God's work and whatever is needed. She's asked me many times, what's your vision? And Diane asked me many times, what's the vision so we can run with this, And that's somebody that wants to do God's work and is hungry. That's not a pride. There's a difference there. A pride, this is not a part of my sermon, but I do that. There's a pride can come into you that where it's about you, and you want to speak because you want people to see you, and you get your affirmation of how big of a crowd that you can speak, how long that you can speak, and the words you can spit out, and how enthralled they are, and that's what you get your thrills. That's a false humility there, and it's a pride that where you got to have that fix, and it's not about you preaching and saying what God wants. I'm not saying to anybody here, but I felt led to say this. It's about you. It's not about God. It's about you getting behind there and speaking. Or how much can you speak or bragging, I got to speak, There's a difference in someone saying, I got to preach tonight, than someone bragging in a prideful way. It's how you say it. It's what's in your heart. And in this area, there's a... in America, it does seem that there's a pride. Not all, you know, I'm not saying just in the church. It's everywhere, you know, and I'm not running down America. God doesn't hate America. You know, if he hated America, we wouldn't be here, you know. I've been saying, because he's God, you know. but it does seem that then, you know, and I think in this area we could focus and tell people that it's not about us, it's about him. And we have been doing that, but I'm just saying. And another thing that I said last week that kind of hit me, a lot of people give prophetic words of, they're false prophets. I'm just going to go ahead and say it. Like, God hates the church. He's mad. He's mad at you. He's mad at this. And he's going to, you know, the bride is, you know, they're just not blah, 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 you know. I want to ask you a question. And I just asked you because you have your sweetheart here with you. And I'm not saying that he does this or you do this, but I'm just going to, I kind of like give illustrations here. I do that when I preach. I try to do that. If he talked to you like people say that Jesus, in the way God talks about his church, would you still be with him? Now think about that. And if it was a part where the only way that he could speak to you was through me, that's kind of what a prophet. When God tells a prophet something, he'll speak to the people. And I'm not saying God speaks to everyone, and I'm not saying that, but just say there's some times that where I had to relay a message. And I'll probably filter that, his message, I'll filter that for my circumstances and what I feel of relationships. And I'll speak it to you. And would you listen to me? Because you know him. You know him, what he feels about you. But if I said that he told me to tell you that he was very upset at you, he's going to curse you, and you're just going to be, you know, rake you over the coals if you don't get down and run up to him and scream and holler and repent, you know, and repent, and he hates you, would you believe that? We need to know God intimately. We need to know when people say that stuff, we need to know, no, that's not my God. That's not my sweetheart. I know him. Now, we need to think about that. That got a lot of people out of prophecy, and it got me out of prophecy. I didn't want anything to do with it because you hear that. I got sick of it. I'm just going to go ahead and say it. About the moon, I got sick of hearing about it, you know, and I know it made some people mad. I'm just going to say it anyway. Just throw it out there. Just let it land, you know. That's what I say. I'm not saying it's, I guess it was wrong. I kind of didn't know that stuff, per se, but we need to talk about what the Lord is saying, though, what he's saying. And we always want God to be something different than what he wants to do now. It's like when Jesus came, they wanted him to be king to destroy Rome, but he came as a lamb. That was the way it had to be. He said, you don't even know the seasons. You need to know the seasons. They was praying for him to come, and he walked right past the temple. He was in the temple, and they was praying for him to come, and he was there. We miss God because of what we want. And the prophetic word sometimes people can get into is what they want, you know, because they're angry. So the God has to be angry because they're angry, you know, or, you know, and they don't like the Super Bowl. So they're going to say God hates the Super Bowl, you know, and stuff like that. And, you know, I know I'm not going to apologize for what I used to apologize a lot. I'm going to get away from that, you know, because that's just what's in my heart. I feel that we need to hear what God is saying and speak it out. Unfiltered, speak it out. And sometimes even little things of I can't remember, there was a word Randy got about early on in his ministry. It was something about a green hose or something. But what he said, he just interpreted that because that's what he knew. And this guy wouldn't stand up. And finally he said, that's it. He said, well, I didn't think it was me because you said holes and it was something else. I can't remember what it was. And he filtered it because of what he knew. He said, spoke it out because that's how he knew it. He saw it, and he thought it was something else because that's how what he knew. And the man, finally, he got healed, but he learned just to say it how he saw it. And I think that's a lot of times with prophecy that we can filter it through our circumstances, our emotions, and what we know. And we need to speak out what God wants to say. And, God loves his people. He wants to love on his people. He wants to give you good things, you know. And I'm not saying all the time, you know, I'm not saying that you can't bring correction, but it needs to be done in the right way. And if you just trust me, sometimes you want to just, get up, believe you, smack. You know, you want to do that. I'm not going to lie to you, but you can't. You kind of just got to reel it in, you know. And I feel that we say sometimes that's God, but it's not. It's just our emotions. And, you know, and two, on the other hand, I want to say this. We're against, like, when a lot of these revivals that God shows up. Every single revival, every single move of God, there's emotions involved. People manifesting, shouting, screaming. Every single one. It's everyone throughout history. And if people say there's one that didn't happen, they're lying. They edited that out. I'm telling you, it happened. The Baptist revivals, the Baptist got founded on. The same thing happened that was in Toronto Blessing and stuff. And manifestations, it happened. Now, let me tell you something. Every relationship, every real relationship, there is emotions involved. If there's not emotions involved, then it's not a real relationship. Come to him. And there's times that where I said, God, I need this. If you want me to stay in the ministry, this has to happen. I've said it many times. Since the founding of Revival is here, I've said, God, if you want this done, this is what I got. This is what I need. I wasn't angry at him. I was just being straightforward and honest what I felt. In any relationship, that happens. You got both of y'all, all of y'all, this happens. You say, this is what I need. This has to happen. You don't hate that other person. You're just being honest. Many times I've got to that point. This is what I need. I told the Lord we needed $1,000 at the very beginning to get the ink, pay for the lawyer, which the lawyer didn't charge very much at all. But you have a fee to all these fees and stuff. And I told the Lord, I said, okay, at the end of this month, if we don't have it, I'm dropping it. We're going to stay what we got. The very last day, we got it. There's a lot of times I said, Lord, if you want me to stay in this area, here lately, I said, Lord, if you want me to stay in this area, I need 20 people to be in a service by February. And the Lord did it. We had 20 people exactly is what she counted. Isn't that something? I said, Lord, if you want me to stay in this area, I'm not going to lie to you. I said, you got to bring Charlotte. Well, I'm not going to fool with it. Yes, I did. I told the Lord, I said, I'm not going to get in the ministry, stay in the ministry in this area. What I want to do is pay off my student loans. Maybe in the future, go move out to Bethel and just work and go and maybe try to get a job at a church and not preach again, you know, still be with the Lord, but, you know, kind of get a, you know, you just kind of, I'm just going to be honest with you. That's what I felt. I was at that point, and that's what I said. And I think it was that day or so, she said, well, I'm on board. She didn't know I said that. And I'm not putting you on the spot. I'm just being honest. I'm just saying. And, you know, you got... Yeah. I felt strongly in my spirit that, you know, if everything was work out, you know, and that's what I said, you know, and you got to get to the point that, okay, God, he said he gives you the desires of your heart. And I'm not saying that all the time in your prayers you're just giving a wish list of this like you do Santa Claus, and I'm not saying that. And your prayer time is your intimate communication with God. You're sitting down and he's talking to you, you know. And God was really downloading me a picture of this movie, and you plug your brain into your computer, and you're kind of like, I was over there like that. And but you got to get to the point, you know, to say, this is what I need, God. This is what I need. I have to have this. And he wasn't upset with me. He didn't hate me because I said, you know, if I don't have this, I'm not going to be in the ministry anymore. He didn't hate me for that. What kind of a relationship would that be? As you look out throughout history, Catherine Kuhlman, she got to that point. All of them, all the ones that's done great things, had to get to the point that they couldn't do it anymore. And they said it had to be God had to do it. Because if you can do it on your own, it's not God. And I had to get to that point. And lately, before things started, you know, to get better, I was at that point. I said, I can't do it anymore. That's what I was saying to the Lord. I cannot do this. Something's going to have to give here. I've done all that I can do. This is what I need. I read a book, James Maloney, he wrote, and he was really big in the healing ministry and emerging the prophetic with the healing, kind of like Branham, basically modern day Branham, really similar to Branham's ministry. Doctrine's a little different, but he'd worked, he traveled, he spoke more times in the year than there was days in the year. I don't know how he did it, but, you know, it was like, I don't know how he could have. I've tried to figure out in my mind how he could speak. And that wasn't a lie. He spoke that much, but I just don't know how he could do it. As a person, he spoke so much, and it wore him out, and he had adrenal fatigue. And the Lord told him, he says, I'm not going to heal you from this. He said, I'm going to use this to where you have to depend on me. So when the Lord comes at times and he kind of, God just surrounds him and just takes over. And he sees these, he calls it panoramic visions. Branham saw this, he done the same thing. And all of them do, they'll see, they call it different terminology. Each one will call it different. But it's just the visions is what it is, you know, or really in-depth things from the Lord, and that they would see things about someone, very intimate details. James Maloney's like that, and he'll say it out. But he got to that point, what I'm getting at, that where he couldn't, you know, and the ministry was his income because he did it all the time. He couldn't have a job. When you get into ministry so deep, that has to be your income because you can't have a job and do the ministry. And that was his income, and he couldn't do the ministry. And he just couldn't do it. He was adrenal fatigue, and it's a really bad. They said a lot of people get that when they push themselves so much. And he had to get to the point of where he said, okay, you know, he literally couldn't do it, and God used that. We have to get to a point to where I know that I can't do it. Then that's when, and actually you end up doing more for the Lord than you couldn't even dream of before. And you're at the point to where you're thinking, I can't do this, and there's nothing left. But you look 2-3 years down the road, you're doing 100 times more than you done back then. When you get to that point that God says, okay, watch what I do. Heidi Baker got to that point. She was going to get out of ministry. She was going to work at a retail store, I think she said, or was going to go to a nunner, join to be a nun, or something like that. And she had a good education too. She had a degree. I think she got. She's actually a doctor from a college. Real, not a fake title. This was a earned. And she got to the point that she just couldn't do it anymore. And she had just a little group in Mozambique, and wasn't very many. And she just couldn't do it. And she got to the point to where, I don't want to be in the ministry, God. I just can't do it. God did not hate her for it. I feel led to go this direction. And she got to that point, and when she went up to Toronto, when she went up there, it was the point that she couldn't make it. And I think if she was actually had a something to do with her feet or something too, I don't know if that was a different time, but it was an illness or something there too, maybe. And I know it would have happened one time, and I think it was the same time. And she went there saying, she just went there to get, she was dry, very dry. And Randy, she ran up towards the front, and Randy pointed at her. He said, God's going to give you the nation of Mozambique. Do you want it? And she said, yes, and God was just giving her all these things. And she was, has ended up starting like 10,000 churches in the area, in the world now. And she has so many kids that's under, that she takes care of now. And it's like more fat, multiplied more and more than she had done before. But when she got to that point to where, I cannot do this, I cannot see me last in the ministry for another 2 weeks or a week or a day. She got to that point. And most of the people that has done great things for the Lord has got to that point to where it's impossible for them to go any farther. They cannot see going any farther. They can't see any more a breakthrough. They cannot see. But it says in the armor of God, it talks about having done all to stand. Stand, therefore. And put on the whole armor of God. So notice it says stand, but before, and then put on the whole armor of God. Paul Crouch and all of them that's done great things for the Lord, it got to the point to where they've done everything that they could. And they just couldn't do anymore. It's like, Lord, if you don't intervene, I'm done. Have we ever been there? This is not what I was going to preach on, but the Lord intervened on this. And God said, he comes down. Paul was, he wanted to go in there and really rake somebody over the coals and get it taken care of. And I think his wife or somebody, or maybe, what's his name? Pope of the Pentecostal Church, they call him. Jack Hayford told him, because that was his pastor, and he said, I think it was him or his wife said, no. Kind of reined him in. We all need someone there to rein us in a little. God uses, And, and another thing, we don't need to get a pride in us. And just kind of need to let that go. The pride, you started the recorder. The pride, you need to let that go. And it's not about us. And I think when God uses that, you get to that, what the devil meant for bad, God will turn it around for the good. And God will use that to kind of get the pride out. Because you get to the point, you can't do it. And all the rest of it, that it's all God. Because you gave up a long time ago. You know what I mean? You died. Now it's not you that liveth, but it's Christ that lives in you. You gave up a long time ago, and then it's all him. The disciples, they gave up, and God made them apostles. The disciples died. God made them apostles. I wasn't meant to preach that, but I did anyway. And Lord, hallelujah. I really like Psalms 87 in the Message translation. And I want to read this. And I like this. I read this and I just loved it. And I want to read this. And obviously this ain't about a sermon I wanted to preach, but I feel led to read this. And I'm not going to apologize. I'm getting away from that because I know this is the Lord's on this. It's in the Message translation. It says, "He found a Zion on the holy mountain, and oh, how God loves his home. Loves it far better than all the homes of Jacob put together. God's hometown. Oh, everyone there is talking about you. I name them off, those among whom I'm famous. Egypt, Babylon, and Philistia, even Tyre, along with Cush. Words getting around. They point them out. This one was born again here. The words getting out on Zion. Men and women, right and left, get born again in her." This is a prophetic word. God registers their names in his book. This one, and this one. Born again right here. Singers and dancers give credit to Zion. All my springs are in you. God just told me when I'm just reading this that this is a prophetic word for revival is here. God told me a long time ago when I did not see it, and I did speak it out, but I didn't see it. But it said revival is here. The church services will be the place to be at in this area. And that's exactly how God said it. It will be the place to be at in this area. And I never saw it, and I spoke it out in faith. And that's what it's talking about with Zion. That's the place to be at. And it talks about that city on the hill. That's a place to be at. Am I right? And that's what he wants for revival is here. People get born again here. I like the word born again instead of saved. I like that. This sounds good to me. And a pastor, he removed me off Facebook because I said that. I don't know why he got upset, but this isn't saved from something. Or I like the word get born again. I like that. And this one and that one is a numbers of them. Let's claim this scripture. God wouldn't show it to you and not give it to you. Am I right? Would he just dangle that in front of you? You can't have that? But it's in scripture. No, it says all the promises of God are yes and amen for them that love the Lord. All of them. But then I'm going to claim it for myself. This is a promise. This is a prophetic word. And I'm going to claim it for revival is here. In the name of Jesus, Lord, I claim this in the name of Jesus. I claim this, Lord, for us, Lord. Lord, I claim this, that we're going to just grow, Lord, in the name of Jesus. And people look at us and know that you're moving, that you're there, a revival is here, that you love us, Lord, in the name of Jesus. And they want to be loved and feel your love like that, Lord, in the name of Jesus. And they'll come and have love encounters with you, God, in the name of Jesus. Glory, hallelujah. The world, Lord, they've already been watching, Lord. They've already been watching, Lord. Lord, just bring in the harvest, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Glory, hallelujah. Glory, hallelujah. I don't want to keep you too much longer. All the stuff that I said, I wasn't aiming to say at all. I didn't have any notes on it. Like I told you, God was downloading me and many stuff over there. And, you know, if it hurts your feelings, that means you just need to get down and pray. That's all I'm going to say. And we learned last week about David and how he was hungry for God. Show me your glory. And I talked a little bit about how God moved early on in my life and stuff. And that's a foundation for revivalists here, is his presence, him moving. That's a foundation to everything that God has me to do, is him moving and showing up. Because without that, we don't have anything. Anybody can study the Bible, but you got to have the presence of God with it. You got to. That's what's going to separate. The devil knows the Bible and he can quote it. We need his presence. We got to be hungry for it. And we found out that David was hungry. And he was hungry. It actually says Holy Spirit. Now, supposedly, and it actually said Holy Spirit. Now, suppose, you know, the Holy Spirit got poured out and on the day of Pentecost. And Jesus breathed on them and said, receive you the Holy Spirit, right? Before that. So that's a New Testament, New Covenant thing, isn't it? David saw what we can have in the New Covenant and pulled it to his time. God showed it to him. That means you can have it. And he cried out to God, and his sin, adultery, she didn't do it. People try to say she did it. She's just taking a bath. She didn't do it. So everybody, you say all you want, running down women. I'm just going to say he was a king. You come or you die. It was his fault. It wasn't the prophet didn't come and say it was her. It was David. And he admitted it. He knew he was wrong. And in that moment, he said, Lord, I need you. I need your Holy Spirit. Take not your Holy Spirit from me. I need your Holy Spirit. Show me your glory. I want it. In his sin, he said, Lord, I need you more. Come on. Glory, hallelujah. We need to be that way. We're so hungry. He said his flesh longed for his glory, his presence. Even his flesh. Okay, now that throws out teaching that said your flesh is nothing. His flesh was even hungry for God's glory. Not just his spirit and inner man. It said his flesh. Isn't that what it said? It's in these scriptures. It's one of these, Psalm 63 or Psalm 51. One of those. It's in there. His flesh. If we want to see something in, we're like they had at Azusa Street, where the glory cloud was at least up to the chairs here. Kids were laying in God's glory. All the time you would walk in there, the services was 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. God's glory was there up to the chairs. You want to see what I wanted? That's what I want. You ask me what I need? That's what I need. That's what I want. I long for that. We want his glory. Bless you, sister. We appreciate you. You know, I'm going to stop to say that, and I know you hate that, but I'm going to say it anyway. Bless you, sister. We love you, and God loves you. And I know you didn't want to hear that, and that's not stopping the moving of the Holy Spirit blessing someone. But I want that. David got to the point, he said, show me your glory. We'll find out Sunday morning or whenever the Lord's willing. It's hard to get serious with me. I like to flow. I'm getting back into that, and that's good. When you see me doing that, you see the increase of the Spirit when I speak, when I just flowing and I don't go by notes and stuff. That's just the way I am. I'm getting back into that, and that's a good thing. And I'm not going to apologize because I've watched Sean and all of them. They do that, and so I felt good that I did that and didn't know anyone else did it. So now I'm seeing, okay, that's normal. So I like that. That makes me feel better. And a lot of things that I would say and preached, I just knew was right. And now I'm seeing all of them, they did that too. So I said, okay, I don't feel bad. But David, he's even his flesh longed for God. He tasted it. He tasted it. You want to know why people people say we have addictive personalities, everybody, you know, that once someone takes the drugs, they get addicted to it, or alcohol and stuff. You know why? Because we're made to be in God's glory. Without that, they try to get substitutions. But let me tell you something. Once you get in that, you're going to be addicted to it. There was people that died after Azusa, when they got older. The problem is they couldn't bring it into where they was. They looked at it as the Azusa, you know, and they didn't get to the point where God wanted to be the carriers of it. They didn't get that far. That wasn't the leadership's fault. It just happened. That's just the way it was. And maybe that's what God planned it. I don't know. It's just the way it is. You can't change it. It happened. You know, but they dwelled on what I talk about it a lot, but I don't talk about it in a way as they got so they couldn't do anything. Like, I mean, elderly, you know, they was younger then, and they got elderly, and they just grieved because this one man just grieved. He said, he talked about the glory, how great it was. See, his flesh was longing for it. But he didn't say, God, that's what I need. I need you. Tell God that. We got to have, once you taste it, cry out to him more and say, it's okay to say, I got to have it. I got to have your glory and daily in my life. Be hungry for him. To the point to where there's people that are hungry, but they don't ask the person that can only can give it. They'll go around to telling everyone else. And I guess it's good saying everybody that you're hungry for God's glory, but and you're not telling the person that can, he's not going to get offended with you. When you say, you think he's going to get mad at you because you said you're not going to go any further without his glory, without his Holy Spirit? You think he's going to get mad at you? He said, that's my son down there. That's my daughter. That's my child. Don't you mess with them. He's going to give it to you. He's going to say, okay, I'm going to give it the glory to you. Walk in it. That man, their flesh was so hungry for it because they tasted that in Azusa. But David, when he knew he was in trouble because a prophet come to him, but he didn't say, don't take this money away from me. Don't take my wife away from me. Don't. He didn't even say, prolong my life. He didn't say, I didn't want to die. He said, I need your presence. He said, choose your punishment. Let it be from you. I need you. Think about that. We need to get that for him. Have that relationship with him like that. You hear what I'm saying? I need your presence. I need your glory. I want you. I don't care. I just want you. I don't care how it is. That's how we need to be for God's glory and his presence. I don't care how it is. I want you. There's people that say that when they show up. Oh, that's the devil. You just sit there and said, you want me to show up? You don't care how I want to show up? Yeah, I don't understand that. They did the same thing to Jesus. Oh, you do that because that's the, you're doing that by the power of the devil. You know, that's actually blasphemy. That is blasphemy is what that is. Saying, attributing something to the devil when it's from God, that's blasphemy of the Holy Spirit. Other people, you might not say it is, but read the Bible. That's what it is. That's what he said. We don't need to get affected by what Jane says. If you're a Jane, if you're like that, that must be a prophetic word. I just said Jane. I'm not picking on someone. I just said Jane. Don't you not worried about what they're saying? If they don't like it or what they think, you don't care. When you get to that point that you're hungry for him, you do not care what anyone else thinks. That you want him. And you've seen. I like to give examples. You know, there's people that, you know, when they're younger, they fall in love with someone. Their parents say, oh, they don't want, you know, and everybody says, you don't need to be with them. I don't care. I want to be with them. They get married, you know. They don't care what anyone thinks. They want to be with them. Right? We need to get that away with God. I don't care what they think. I want God. I don't care what their denomination thinks. I want God. I don't care what Mr. Control Freak thinks. I want God. If you're not coming with me, you're going to get left behind. I'm going forward with him. The problem is we want to look back like Lot's wife looked back. They didn't want to come, and that's what she looked back for. It wasn't the lights of the city. It was the people. Her family members, the people. I did a sermon on that. The man wanted to follow Jesus. He said, oh, I got to bury someone. He said, let the dead bury the dead. We can't look back. That's the same situation that happened in the Old Testament. There was an illustration in the New Testament about it. The same reason. I love you, but bye. Can't go to heaven on my salvation. You gotta cry out to him yourself. We gotta get to that point. We are hungry, and can you imagine? Like God told me, he said, "You give me a congregation of 200 people that's hungry for him." He said, "You give me a congregation." This is how he told me. You give me a congregation of 200 people that's hungry for me, I'll change the world with them. Now, can you imagine? That's prophetic for revivalists here. Because there's enough people we can have that'll very, you know, 200 people's not even really putting a dent in the population in these several counties. Can you imagine? They'll be hungry for God. 200 congregation, children, youth, adults, 200 that are hungry for him that way. All Davids. Can you imagine what we can do for God? Can you imagine the glory is going to roll up in that place? This a building that we're in will be shaking like it was. They was hungry for God. in the New Testament, and God come in so strong that literally the building shook. And there's no pride in hunger. You don't care what you look like. You see, like, these soldiers coming home. Like, see, well, good examples. There's some dog videos that where their owner come home. This dog's just going crazy in the airport. He don't care that he, man, or I don't know. I just say he, the dog doesn't care what anyone thinks. He's happy. So when God comes down on you, you don't care if you're slobbering or laughing, cackling or rolling or roaring or crunching or whatever it is. You don't care what anyone thinks. You're not doing it for them. You're happy being in his presence because he's coming down. You finally got what you've longed for. And longing shouldn't just be for a one encounter. It should be a constant thing. And saying, hey, I need you. I'm not going to go without you. Moses, we'll get into that. Moses said, I'm not going to leave without you. Sorry, ain't going to happen. He told God that. God told him to go. He said, nope, not going to happen. That's exactly what he said in my language. Not going to happen. If you don't go, I'm not going to go. Sorry, ain't going to happen. I need you with me. That's a good relationship there. You know, he didn't get upset. He's like, I kind of like that. I just can feel that's what God was thinking. You ever love someone and you like someone and you're going to do something and or you tell them to go? But you're doing that, actually, it's kind of like, I wonder how much they like me. Just go on. Just go ahead. I'm not going. You're thinking, I wonder how much they like me. And they stop. Sorry, I'm not going to go without you. It's like exactly what I wanted to hear. I don't know exactly if that was that case or not, but you kind of think, you kind of see how that could be. Do they really love me? Would you rather stay back here in the desert with someone you love, with no water or, you know, and stuff? Or be in a city where it's lush and have all the food, but they're not there, where would you rather be? That's love. When you get to that point, he will bring you before kings. Your shadow is going to heal the sick. God will sow into that, bring you finances. The first, come on, you got pride and you're thinking, I'm the first, you know, and it's about me. You're going to be the last. And the last, people saying, you know, I just need you. True humility, I need you. They're going to be first. He's going to know you. It's not going to be about works. It's not going to be about me. It's not going to be, you know, doing things, work. I'm not a worker, and I'm not doing it to get attention. The first thing they say, well, look what I done. Didn't I done that? You know, you've seen a lot of that in that passage. There was a worker, and it was about them. There's two things in that passage. There was a worker. They wasn't his son. Or child, we're all sons of God. If a man can be a bride of Christ, a woman can be a son of God. Jesus done said there's no genders when you pass away. You're like the angels. I'm not going to get into that. I'm just saying that's what he said. Take it up with him. I don't know. I haven't died yet, so I can't tell you. What was I saying? He had to keep me up here. Anyway, I don't know what I was saying. Yeah, I kind of lost myself on that. Anyway, we need to be hungry for God. I lost myself. I went on a rabbit trail and I forget, couldn't find my way back. But we need to be hungry for God. We need to. That's the focus. And if you want His glory, ask Him for it and be hungry for it, and He'll give it to you. You know, He's going to give it to you. But don't put stipulations on it. Don't be like, well, you know, I don't get emotional. Well, you'll probably be the most emotional one in the whole bunch when God comes down. You know, you're the emotional one. You'll probably be the quietest one in the bunch when God comes down. You don't run, well, God will have you running up and hanging off the lights, probably. You don't know. You know, it's just the way it seems, you know. And, you know, just the way it is. And you'll be happy doing it. That's the thing. It's not about, you know. It's like we misinterpreted Jonah trying to say God was going to force him to go somewhere way over somewhere, and he didn't say, oh, you got to do what. The problem, Jonah didn't go because he wanted them to be destroyed. That's why he didn't go. He wanted them to be destroyed. That was his excuse. It's not like he was talking like, you know, what's getting on a plane and going free, you know, all the way over to Africa, you know, and God's going to force you to go. And we always preach that. I don't believe that God's going to force you to go to Africa if you don't want to go. And we misinterpret that scripture. That's the whole thing is he went way, way away from way over this way. And Nineveh was right here. But he went way over this way. So it's not like he was trying to, it had to do with traveling, is what I'm saying. He didn't want to go because he knew that God would relent. God told him to go. He knew that God would relent. And that's why he didn't want to go. He wanted them destroyed. And he got upset when they wasn't destroyed. He threw a pity party. That's our mentality now, isn't it? We get all upset. Other people prophesied that California was going to get swallowed up in the ocean, going to be a little island, and they hear all these prophets, ooh, don't go to California, it's going to be an earthquake, and it's going to sink into the ocean. Didn't happen, did it? Guess what? God loves California too, doesn't he? Why would we want to wish something like that? They wanted it to happen. It didn't happen, did it? So, and I was the one that was prophesying, revival's coming to California. God's going to send a revival to Hollywood. God's going to do great things in California. God says that California is the chosen land. God's going to do something great in California. I kept posting that. Not very many likes, of course, because I didn't say God's going to see California in the ocean. If you want to get a lot of likes, prophesy some judgment. Everybody, I love you. They want it. We want that. I don't get up. People get upset with saying this. I'm just going to say it anyway. But guess what? Guess what God is doing? He's doing great things in California. They were in that 200,000-seat Coliseum and going to fill it with people, Azusa now. 200,000-seat Coliseum. That sounds like some good stuff there, doesn't it? I'm just saying. That's something I had to get delivered from, I guess, too, in a way. I kind of thought when I was younger that's what prophecy was. Sometimes, you know, got to prophesy judgment, you know. True prophetic conference is prophesying. And it says, if you have all this but don't have love, you have nothing. I know I went a little bit longer than I was going to, but I'm sorry. No, I'm not sorry. I'm not going to apologize, because that's what I feel God saying. See, when you have two services, it break it up, my rambling. So. I like to aggravate. But God is good, isn't he? Amen. See, we got into a lot of stuff tonight, didn't we? We got it covered a lot. And I hope we got the recordings if you didn't get all of it. But I probably touched pretty much almost every subject in the Bible almost tonight. So just the way I do. Almost. That's what usually happens when God, you know, you listen to Sean, he just rambles and on, and but if you listen to what he's saying, it's all good. You know, deep stuff. You know, just from here and there, you're just pulling it. That's what you're getting, so you just speak it out, you know. And that's what we need, you know. So we'll go on more about this. Remember, Sunday mornings starts at 11, and class starts at 10:30, and the Sunday morning service, class is at 10:30, and the Sunday morning service starts at 11. Yeah, probably gonna have, I don't know if it'd be full the first service or not, but it'd be a lot of people, and Sunday nights, and have a good time in the Lord too, and gonna be good, ain't it? I like to see all these speakers, revivalists come eventually, and we get our own building, just get them to come. Jake said he's gonna wants to come in 2 months from Bethel, and that's my heart too, is to get all these people that's burning to bring them here so we can light our. That's what I want to see. Amen. Was it Yagi Cho or from South Korea said, you want to do something for the Lord, you got to be around the movers and the shakers or something like that. And that's what I want. Rub off on me, you know. And impartation. We've lost that teaching too, hasn't we? The impartation. So praise the Lord. And I'm going to let Charlotte speak for a little bit. I think if she got something to say. Do you got something to say, Diane?
I just want prayer for the Ketter family.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, and she was 29, 28? And she was from Trimble County originally, I guess. She was younger than my sister. Yeah. Seemed like by the pictures you could tell. It's really, yeah, we need to pray for them. I'm glad you reminded me. Yeah, that's something. I've been thinking about that all week. I didn't feel led to really, because sometimes you might need a little time to grieve personally. You know I do. And so I'm definitely want to get a hold of him again pretty soon. But I felt, you know, maybe they needed some time to. Yeah, that's good. Maybe we can get them some food or something as a church. That'd be good. Was you wanting to pray for that?
I
mean, as a church, lead us in prayer over as a church, or I can't either. I just mean as a church group to pray. Yeah.
Oh, Father God, Lord, we come to you as your children, who you love and who you care for. And Father, we recognize that you also love us when we grieve and when we have had a loved one to come home and be in your presence. And right now, Lord, we come together in agreement and we lift up this family to you, the entire family, for everyone is touched and everyone is affected in some way or another when there is the death of a loved one in the natural. Father, we thank you that we have a firmness and a security that when they are absent from us, that they are present with you. And Lord, I ask that you send comfort and peace through your Holy Spirit to this family, that you would bring them understanding of why and how all this came to be. Father, I ask that you would just touch the husband and make him strong and let him be well-rounded and well-grounded in you, Father, that he can minister and be a father to the four remaining children who stay here with so many questions. Father, I ask that the life that Leslie lived, Father, would be so ingrained into her children already at their age that they will always know how special and unique and how blessed they were by her being their mother. Father, I seek that for your kingdom to come into this situation and that you would have workers and even myself, Lord, whoever is available for whatever is needed, Father, that you would put your workers in place around this family for whatever it is that they need, whenever they need it, that when that need surfaces, that there will be suddenly someone to take care of it. Suddenly, Father, an obedient oracle of you to speak. Suddenly, Father, the Holy Spirit flooding into their lives and into their circumstances. Father, I lift them up, and in this time, in this very vulnerable time, Father, as your body, we unite together and we form a hedge of protection around them that no further assault from the enemy would come near them, that no weapon that is even being formed right now, as I pray, will prosper against them, Father, but they will be shielded and protected right now so that they can grieve and heal and move on with life, Father. Lord, whatever it is that we can do to help them, let your Holy Spirit speak to us, even in the midnight hours, Father. Wake us up, shake us awake, and put us to move. Father, as we sang earlier, we said we give you our hands, and we give you our feet, and we give you our everything, Lord, to be what you need us to be. And Father, I'm asking that you would just drive us, let your Spirit just press us in to being what this family needs for us right now. Father, help us to know, to be ready in season and out of season. In Jesus' name, I pray. Amen and amen. Amen. Thank you, Lord.
Yes, Lord. Touch him in the name of Jesus, Lord. Would you, Diane and Charlotte, do a closing for the people watching around the world and pray for them and lead them to Jesus and...
You know, I have to tell you, I'm still very thankful that this is made out of good solid wood. I mean, I'm just, I don't like to use the word staggering, but I mean, I'm just still so full of the Holy Spirit right now that, I mean, I just feel that presence and it just never left through the whole service. I do want to say this, though. When you're hungry, when you're truly hungry for the presence of God, you can say it. But when you worship, there's this thing when you worship that says, you know, shout to me, reach for me, kneel for me, you know, seek me, press into me. Don't be reserved with what you want. You know, the Bible clearly says many times, you know, that we have to take some things by force. Now, I don't think that we can force God to do anything. All right, so let's not make this all crazy and you know, something that it's not. But I think in our physical body, our natural body doesn't line up well with the spirit realm sometimes. So sometimes we force ourselves to give a shout of hallelujah, or we force ourselves to yield to what the spirit wants from us. You know.
And in saying that,
you're on.
You'll find that, you know, if you ask for that, you know, on a regular basis, just keep it with you. Because as you sit there and you're listening, or, you know, someone else is praying or giving a word, it's going to come out naturally. And it doesn't hurt, and it doesn't take time, and it doesn't feel wrong. Feels right.
One of the best feelings in the whole world is when you finally, you know, a lot of times when I'm worshiping and the Lord will show me something, you know, like for tonight, he showed me that he was really here. You know, he kept saying, quit asking me to take you up when I've come down to you. You know, so I was like, okay, you're here. I see, I hear, you're here. I feel you, you're here. But in yielding to that, my flesh was crying and sobbing. Because my flesh is an enemy with God. And that battle to let go in the spirit to receive the things of God, sometimes our emotions just do weird things. I'm not sad that he was here. It was just that release of finally in that place. And it's hard to explain, but you just got to, you know, when it says I'm going to lift up holy hands, don't. Lift up your holy hands. You know, when it says I'm going to shout to heaven, I'm going to shout and let the praises ring. Well, that doesn't mean glory, hallelujah. It means I'm going to shout and I'm going to let praises ring. You know, I'm going to say, I'm not going to say hallelujah, oh hallelujah, oh hallelujah. It's going to be hallelujah. And I mean, you guys have seen that. So do this. You know, faith is an action word. You can believe, you can say you believe all you want to, but if you don't actively do something to display your faith, it makes it difficult.
And when Pastor Chan was talking to me about the children, I started weeping, just crying. Tears just ran down my face because it seems that I do have the gift with children. And what the Lord puts upon me is I see faces. I see faces of kids. Ones that are crying out that need what we can give them. Every single face has a different story. And I want to meet, and I know everybody does, want to meet the needs of those kids. They're out there. But as he was talking, I just, you know, faces. Even in, it looked like I was in Mexico, sitting on the side with my guitar and a group of kids, little Spanish speaking, teaching me how to do it, kids, you know, but they're everywhere. Talks way more than I do.
Now, don't say that here. You get that anointing, the bramble anointing on you. And so, I mean, Jennifer said she couldn't speak it. She'd taken the mic a lot last week and speak it. So, don't say you can't because you'd be the one that's speaking. I'm not saying it to make fun of her. I'm saying it in a good way.
I will.
All right.
Can I?
Absolutely.
All right.
Skip Girls, I think.
Oh, thank you, Lord. Father God, oh, what an awesome time we've had playing in your presence as your children play in the presence of their parents. Father God, we just enjoy you so much. And to feel you're pleased with us, you're smiling down on us, and how you enjoy us. Lord, we are truly thankful from the bottom of our hearts, just truly thankful. We praise you, Lord. Father, right now, I just want to take a moment as we conclude our service. I thank you for such wonderful words and such encouragement. Father, I thank you for the man of God, and I thank you for the anointing and the vision that you've given him for this area. Father, I am thankful that you have spoken to me again about a season and a time and a place. Amen. I am thankful for the team that you have brought here to Revivalist here. Father, right now, as we close this service, it just would not be right to not offer the same joy to someone else. So if you have watched this service and you're not quite sure, if you were to die today, in the next moment, whether or not you would be in the presence of a holy God for all eternity, yes, to dance and to sing, to feel that love and that peace and that contentment, I want you to know that it is so possible. It is so possible for you. It doesn't have to be a big announcement. It doesn't have to be a party. You don't have to go to anybody, and you don't have to be embarrassed. Right there. Amen.
Right there. It won't cost you a thing.
Right where you're at. If you would just repeat these words after me. Lord Jesus, I believe that you are the Son of God.
I believe that you're the Son of God.
I believe that you were born of a virgin.
I believe you were born of a virgin.
I believe that you lived a life as a man.
I believe you lived a life as a man.
Completely surrendered to God the Father.
Completely surrendering to God the Father.
I believe that you were crucified for me.
I believe you were crucified for me.
That you were brutally beaten.
You were brutally beaten.
Brutally struck down.
Brutally struck down.
For the redemption of my sins.
For the redemption of my sins.
I believe that you were hung on a cross to die.
I believe you were hung on a cross to die.
I believe that you rose from the dead in 3 days.
I believe you rose from the dead in 3 days.
I believe that you now sit at the right hand of Father God.
I believe you sit at the right hand of the Father God.
I believe that you are my Savior.
I believe that you are my Savior.
I believe that through the blood that you shed.
I believe through the blood that you shed.
I am healed of all sickness and disease.
I am healed of all sickness and disease.
By my confession of belief in you.
By my confession of belief in you.
I receive eternal life.
I receive eternal life.
I believe that I am born again.
I believe that I am born again.
And that you are living in my heart.
And that you are living in my heart.
As Lord and Savior.
As Lord and Savior.
Father God, I come to you.
Father God, I come to you.
And I thank you.
And I thank you.
For your Son.
For your Son.
Who paid a price.
Who paid that price.
For me.
For me.
Amen.
Amen.
Now, if you have just repeated that prayer with me and you have never accepted Christ as your Lord and Savior, I would encourage you that if you are in the Northern Kentucky area, and you are near Oldham County, that you would come and join us, that you would make contact with us on the website and let us know that you just received Christ as your Lord and Savior for the very first time. We want to talk to you. We want to be friends with you. We want to encourage you. We want to be a part of your life. We want to see you grow. We love you. We praise God for you. And we are blessed by you.
Amen.